Well, I want to thank Joyce, wherever she happens to be. Joy, I want to thank Joyce Brand and, of course, Sky Conway for putting this on and having me out here. Appreciate that. Wow. Well, I really appreciate everyone getting up so early on a Saturday. I usually wouldn't be up for another few hours. Thank goodness the show was at 1. Again, thanks for everyone coming in. Undermining the false concept of a state. The whole talk should be nothing more than, well, how do we show that the state isn't real, or there is no state, or that government is illegitimate? I should only have to get up here and just say, well, the means are not consistent with the end. Good night. And that should be all I have to say. Right? You know, but to most people in this crowd, that should be all I have to say. But unfortunately, we have a lot of conditioning and whatnot. Because how many people went to public school? Yeah. When did they start teaching citizenship? Well, as far as what grade level were you in? Do you remember when they started teaching citizenship? Does anyone remember? I was pretty young. Sometimes in kindergarten they get the little citizenship thing in there and they get a grade on that. But I tell you, did they actually ever teach you in school what a citizen was? Anyone? Anyone? Bueller? Anyone? Wow.
A good slate.
Wow. That was an indirect teaching. But they never actually get into the concept that it's so important about what a citizen is in states, and they tell you about the states and the revolution, and they had this, and the colonies went to states, and they did all this. But did they ever tell you what a state really was? Anyone? They never taught me. I went to school in Long Island, so we can excuse why I don't know anything, but most of you probably did not go to school there, so you probably had a pretty good education. But did they ever teach you what a citizen was? Anyone? So they told you what a citizen did, but they didn't tell you what a citizen was.
Not so much as diagrams sometimes, but we knew that we could get that citizenship grade. Good. I'm a high school teacher.
You're a high school teacher? Yeah, you can leave now. Yes.
I don't get hired very easily. I walk out of a lot of jobs. But because they're not doing it right. But, you know, we were just assuming that we follow orders, we get the citizenship grade.
Yeah. Well, that's like we were talking about, the indirect teaching. They don't teach you what it is. They teach you what to do. What? Yes.
Member of the state. I think that's why I'm
called. You're getting pretty close. You're getting pretty. I'm sorry.
A co-owner of the state.
A co-owner of the state. Wow. Wow. That's getting technical. Okay. I wrote a book called Adventures in Legal Land. How many people here have a copy? Wow. See, public humiliation is kind of my forte, so that's why I would do something so stupid. And how many people have listened to my show? Wow, even less. So the people who bought the book aren't listening to the show? See, a smart man would walk off right now. It's just, okay. Well, the book, Adventures in Legal Land, the subtitle is Where Black is White and White is Black and Other Shocking Discoveries from America's Courtrooms. And what I did was I put this book together, kind of expose the myth that is the state, or the concept of the state, or citizens. And I used real experiences. Everything that happened in the book really did happen. I changed names. They're all real, though. It's just I swapped them out. I wasn't quite as bold and as I am now. I like getting on the radio and telling people not to pay taxes every week, which is kind of which I'll say again here today a number of times. But the names are all real, so when you see Paul Gruden, that's a real IRS agent. You can look him up. He works in the Tempe office in Phoenix. I just made him a police officer in the book. Earl Carroll is a real federal judge. You can Google him. He's a federal judge in Phoenix. So the names are real, but they're kind of swapped around. I won't be doing that in the new book. Everything is going to be where it should. And so what I was doing was using court experiences to deconstruct the concept of a state. So what does it matter? Because a lot of times people come in and they'll theorize, they'll philosophize, whatever the word is, but you got to prove it. So one of the things that we get into when you're into libertarianism is this whole, like what we heard last night, you hear a lot about religion and objectivism and all this. And so one thing you can do, that I'm going to do is show you, is that unlike with the religious aspect, I'm going to use empirical evidence and absolutely prove without any, beyond all doubt whatsoever, that there's no such thing as a citizen or a state. And it doesn't even take that long. All it is, like I say on the book, it's public relations to keep you paying taxes. That's all it is. To keep you in line. It's like what those ants outnumber us, at least 100 to 1. And if they ever figure it out, there goes our way of life. It's not about the food. It's about keeping you ants in line. As long as you think that you're a citizen or resident of a non-existent state, you're going to continue paying taxes. Right? Pretty much. So let's deconstruct that. The state, let's use the, since I'm from Arizona, it's a little easier. Was there, is he in 1070? Anybody here a supporter of Bill 1070 in Phoenix, in Arizona? Anyone? Anyone? Anyone against it?
What is it?
Senate Bill 1070? You have not heard this? That is where the Arizona state government wanted to make it a crime to be in Arizona illegally. And you're not a citizen. So, yeah, I know. Well, we're going to laugh at that. We've had a standing $5,000 challenge on my radio show, The No State Project, for about, my gosh, a few years now. And we'll extend this to everybody here, because Paul will be here today if you want to take his cash. Anybody who can produce empirical evidence of a citizen or state, we're talking about American, although it doesn't really matter, if you can produce empirical evidence of a state and citizens, $5,000 cash. And if you want, he'll put that in some kind of escrow account to make sure that you, if you prove it, you'll get it. But it's impossible. We kind of know it's kind of a sucker's bet. So let's look at what it is. Is the state, let's see, state of Arizona, was there a state of Arizona prior to February of 1912? What? Just shout them out if you know them.
No.
We're informal here, guys. I don't wear a tie. So the answer is no, right? Was the land of Arizona there? So is Arizona different from the state of Arizona? Heck yes. I've even had a federal judge, not a federal judge, she was a municipal judge, Paula Burgess. You can look her up online. She still is a pro tem judge in Mesa. She told the truth when it came to the state. Very rare. But they get so frustrated with me questioning it that they had to do something. We've had 5 proceedings with this idiot already. We don't want to get into this. So right at the very beginning, I'm taking judicial notice that the state of Arizona is an act of Congress. Wow. Yeah. Does everyone believe that? Who didn't believe it? Why don't you believe that?
Well, there was an incident convention.
No, actually, he was correct. The state of Arizona is an act of Congress signed by the president. It's a piece of paper. So I said, oh, great. We don't need a trial unless you can tell me that you have a witness to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that I was within that act of Congress on this day. How do you think that went? Didn't work out too well for them. Can you imagine a police officer having to prove your presence within the state and the judge judicial notice that it was an act of Congress? Yeah. Because then they come out and they just want to say, well, I saw you on Greenfield in Maine on this day. Well, does that mean I'm within the state of Arizona? No, it means I was on Greenfield in Maine. Which, of course, you'll get the cheapest gas in Mesa, by the way, if you happen to be there. All right, so let's get back. All right, let's look at it from a legal standpoint and see if we can see if there's any evidence. We know it's an act of Congress, but let's look at what a citizen is supposed to be, something they didn't teach you in any of these schools. And I'm going to pick on David Beto is here. Give a shout out to David. Editor of the Voluntary City, which everybody should have a copy of. Does everyone have a copy of that? After you get a copy of Adventures in Legal Land, get a copy of The Voluntary City, please, right? Excellent book, by the way, sir. Do you guys teach at the school what a citizen is?
I don't.
You don't. You should be. After this, next time we talk, you got to be teaching this. A citizen, and I'm not pulling this out of thin air, it's Loria versus United States. I don't know the actual citation, but it's in the book. I thought maybe you'd have it. Anyway, it's Loria versus United States. It's the United States Supreme Court. And they define a citizen legally as a member of the body politic owing a duty of allegiance in return for a duty of protection. These are reciprocal obligations, one a consideration for the other. Has anyone ever heard that before? You guys have read the book at midnight ranges. Good Lord. Are you reading the book, people? Okay. Let's break that down just a little bit, okay? Now, is anyone familiar with this relationship between allegiance and protection? Does this sound familiar to anybody?
Feudalism.
Someone's...
Feudalism.
Say it again.
Feudalism.
Yes.
Serfdom.
It's a fealty. It's an oath of fealty. It's an oath of allegiance. You know, when someone gets naturalized, what do they have to do? They have to put the hand to the square and swear an oath of
allegiance.
So it's the old English common law thing that allegiance draws with it protection, protection draws with it allegiance. Right? Now, we'll go through, I want to go through, so legally there's no citizen, and just morally or economically there are no citizens. How did the duty of allegiance and the duty of protection arise? Well, let's look at it. Are taxes compulsory or are they voluntary?
Compulsory.
So, could someone really have a duty to protect you if it's compulsory? Someone said Al Capone before, right?
Yeah.
So, if Al Capone was getting protection money from speakeasy, was he obligated to protect them? What?
Sure.
Yeah, well, wow, if you... Well, of course not. It's all by violence. It's all compulsory. That's why I mentioned before, all I should have to say is, well, the means are not consistent with the end. Because like I say on the show, if they were really looking to protect your life, liberty, and property, they wouldn't be the first ones threatening to take it, right? But that's what they do. Well, pay us or we'll kill you. So, they couldn't be of a duty to protect, even legally or even economically. But let's look at it legally. Legally, does the government have any duty to protect anybody in the state?
No.
Just shout it out.
No.
No. How do we know this?
Supreme Court.
Supreme Courts? Is it just one Supreme Court that said that?
No, it's several.
Every Supreme Court has said that. Is it just the United States? No. I have Canadian citations, English, Australia, and New Zealand. It's all the same thing. Because if they had a duty to protect you, now let's look at LA for example. If they had a duty to protect you, wouldn't that be actionable when they didn't? And your car was stolen, or your house was broken into, or someone breaks into your car this afternoon and takes your iPod? Would be actionable. If you did sue them, and many people have, this is how I know this stuff, if you did sue, let's say you sued the city of LA for not protecting you because you were mugged, what would a battery of attorneys, that's a scary thought, what would a battery of attorneys file in response to your complaint? They file a demur here in California. And they would say, you failed to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. You have no cause of action because you did not state a case. I know, you're frowning. You're looking like... Did anywhere in your education about American government, did they teach you what a case was? Anyone? Professor Beto? shocked. This fine institution of higher learning, an accredited American college, university. Paul's here, everyone. Well, you see, Paul, I've already put your money up again. Paul is the one that is going to, he's the one that's putting up the money for this state challenge to prove that there's a state. And he's going to be, because we have a bunch of statists in here, you could just pass the book out to those who don't have it. They'll be more than happy to pay you for that because they won't be able to leave otherwise. Okay. Because we're all citizens, right? You have to pay your fair share. But anyway, to get back, the government has no duty to protect you, and they've told us that. There are many, many Supreme Court cases. Anyone here ever go to law school? It's okay, we're all among friends. No one? No one? Oh, wow, okay. Well, the thing is, you when you go through law school, and I guess Butler isn't here yet, when you go through law school, you there's a certain case that you go through where you understand and you get black letter law, as they call it, is unambiguous, where the Supreme Court of the United States in DeShaney versus County of Winnebago, which is one of many, many cases, that the government is under absolutely no duty to protect anybody. So if you look in the government code here in California, I think it's section 945, but don't quote me on that. It is in the government code that you cannot hold the government responsible for failing to provide police protection. Nice, huh? Yeah, really. So that's why I put in my videos that when, and I overlay that, Salazar versus City of Antioch is where the California Court of Appeals, which the Supreme Court did not review because it didn't disagree with it, where the Court of Appeals stated, this is a direct quote, police officers have no statutory duty to do anything.
What about donuts?
Wow. Maybe the Dunkin' Donuts and Krispy Kreme and whatnot, they have a duty to keep them in business, but they have no duty to do anything, they said, so that includes protection. So that's why in my videos, what I'll do is a repeating motif, I will overlay that with the video on the video of the police officers pinning down a suspected gang member and beating the living crap out of them. They have no duty to protect anybody, so what are they doing beating the heck out of this guy? So they tell us legally, and we know that the fact that taxes are compulsory, no duty to protect us could be created. So what does that mean? What are the implications of that? This hit me years ago, because I had gotten into all this stuff about citizens. Well, citizens are a member of the body politic, duty of allegiance in return for protection. But there's no duty to protect anybody. What does that mean about allegiance? Does anybody owe allegiance?
No!
So if you don't have a duty of allegiance, you don't have a duty of protection, are there any citizens?
No!
No.
Yes.
Back! We've got a challenge right here we'll do after the talk. if you can prove that there are citizens, Paul's going to lose some money. Now, there's no empirical evidence, right? Right?
The 14th Amendment.
What about it?
It says about citizens of the United States, the 14th Amendment.
Okay. And that's in the Constitution, right? And the Constitution is what?
It's a agreement about...
That's an opinion. Tell me what it is factually.
Constitution, the document...
Thank you. That's the answer. Did anyone sign it? Did anyone sign it in any manner as a signatory or to make themselves responsible to it as an agreement?
No.
So it's just a piece of paper. They said, if you read it, it says what? In witness thereof. Nobody signed it in any manner that it could be binding as an agreement. As Lysander Spooner wrote in Constitution, no authority, no treason, the Constitution has no inherent authority. If it has any authority at all, it's as a contract, and it doesn't even purport to be a contract. And even if we accepted it, I'm going to paraphrase a little now, even if we accepted it as a contract, which no court in the country, so-called, would ever enforce the contract, the Constitution as a contract, if you did accept it as a contract, it only applied to anybody who agreed to it then, in 1787. We'll just say, well, they signed it. We'll just assume they signed it to make themselves responsible. So only the people who actually signed it could be held responsible to its terms. They're all dead. And Michael Sanders Spooner said, someone says, I am building this hotel for me and my posterity. That doesn't mean your kids have to live in it. Ah, the old man's crazy. I don't want to live in L.A. I'd rather live in Big Bear. So the Constitution doesn't help because there's no connection. It's just a piece of paper. I mean, I've gone into court and I've gone into depositions. I've done it on the phone. And I have a certified copy of the Constitution. And I lay it out. And what is it? Yeah. It's the supreme law of the land. That's what it says. What is it, though? And then you tell them, well, it's four pieces of paper. Well, oh, well, yeah. Okay. I have in the book of Richard Kennedy, who's an IRS district counsel, said to me, you want me to say the Constitution's a piece of paper. Well, that's stupid. Well, I think whether it's true or not is what's relevant. It may be stupid, but is it true or not? So what's really stupid is you think four pieces of paper from 230 some odd years ago gives you and your client a right to my client's house. Now that's stupid. Because if I said this piece of paper gave me a right to your house, you'd rightly, tell me where to go. You seem to think that these four pieces of paper in Washington, D.C. that no one gets to even look at or touch, you seem to think that gives you a right to my house. Raving nonsense. So we show that we can show empirically that there are no citizens. So if there are no citizens, is there a body politic?
No.
Seth, you know this stuff. Just especially when someone like Seth isn't saying anything, I'm okay. So if we don't have a body politic, is there a state?
No.
Well, if you have no states, is there a United States?
No.
Here's a tough one. If you don't have a state, and you don't have citizens, is there a government?
No.
So what do you have?
Individuals.
Guys with guns. This is why I define government, and we can prove this, nothing more than a group of men and women providing a service on a compulsory basis. And a service that they don't even have to provide, right? So, what, I'm sorry?
How much of a service?
Well, people will go through and say, well, what about the roads? So how many people you were willing to personally shoot to build a road? I'm glad to hear that. Is there anybody here who is willing to shoot somebody or take their house by force in order to build a road? How about a library? Okay, hey, I'll get a tough one for Professor Beto. How about to build a university?
University for a football stadium.
Well, and that too. You know, that's why I laugh when you hear these neocon or these. I'm sorry?
Shoot Fred Phelps.
No shooting. Unless they are initiated in the force first. But that's why I laugh when I hear these talking heads, these conservative Republicans saying, well, that's socialism and you can't have socialism. Really? Do you watch college football? And then you got guys like Sean Hannity that love the military, yeah, support the troops. That's socialism. That is taking property from one group of people and giving it to another. So if you've got a problem with government health care, you should have a problem with college football. We're getting through. Well, thank you. So we see that the concept of a state is absolutely false, empirically false. We can prove this. We can actually prove this. But when you talk to people, and you start talking about libertarianism, you start talking about agorism or anarchy or voluntarism, you start getting these emotional responses. I've actually had people argue with me when I tell them taxes are compulsory. I deal with a lot of people, you know, doing a radio show, and by a lot I mean like 12. Yes. Hey, we're going to like triple the size of the audience this afternoon, which is cool. But yet you get these responses. Why is it that you can undermine the entire concept of a state and people will still fight you and defend it? Does anyone have any idea why?
The human mind is easily controlled.
Okay. I'm sorry? Stockholm syndrome, and we've updated that to the battered citizen syndrome. You get the crap beaten out of you, but we gotta pay for the roads. You don't understand him. He's kicking the crap out of you. You have to leave him. But you don't understand. He builds the roads. Right? You just don't understand.
How do you use the battered citizen?
I'm sorry?
How do you use the battered citizen syndrome? You don't believe that as a citizen?
It's just a phrase. It's to describe somebody who's still caught up in that mindset. He just can't let go. Because one of the... I'm sorry, you have a question?
Well, I was going to submit that it's really the tribal imperative.
The tribal imperative? That explains it too?
Feel very uncomfortable having the tribe diminished.
Yes, there is an artist, I don't remember who did it, it's a very simple drawing, and it says it all. And I mentioned this in Nashua a couple years ago, and it kind of sums up what I think is the human tragedy. And if you imagine you got a cartoon, and you know, with the thought, you get that bubble. Okay, so we're all thinking the same thing, and it's like, what a bunch of clueless sheep. And it sums it up. Because I think deep down, people know government's the problem. But we know government's the problem. But we don't know how everyone else is going to respond to that. We don't know how you're going to react to that. We don't know if you believe that. So the tragedy is, we all know that government has to be abolished as soon as society is ready for it. But we don't stand up and do anything about it because we don't think you believe it. Or you or anyone. You know? You imagine that we all want it abolished as soon as possible, but we're not brave enough or confident enough to stand up and do what's right. That's a tragedy. Especially when you got the internet, you got instant communication to get this stuff out there. Where some schmuck from Long Island can sit in his home studio and reach people in Australia. Okay, so there's really no excuse. But that is taking apart the concept of a state. Now, it's helped and been very, very effective in court, and I use this on a regular basis. And I'm not saying that you have to know law inside and out. You don't. One of the easiest ways to deconstruct this and show that they don't have a case against you, because they never do, I'll explain what a case is in a moment, is just to ask them point blank very simple questions. Take what they give you, like they say you're a citizen, you ask them questions about that. Well, factually, what is a citizen? You don't have to know anything about taxes, do you? You can ask them, is there a factual difference between income and taxable income? Well, no, Norm, stop. They will say, yeah. What are they? Even better, you just ask him if he knows what they are. Well, do you know what the factual differences are, sir? And you could go on the website, markstevens.net, and you can hear phone calls with the Franchise Tax Board admitting they don't know. I don't know what they are either, but the point is there is no such thing as taxable income. But what better thing to have on your behalf than the agents who say you owe taxes admitting they're not qualified to say that? And Norm, you've been listening long and said you've heard the phone calls where I've had them. I said, well, look, I'm not an attorney. Just, you know, let me know what the process is. Don't worry about the law. Doesn't matter. You ask them what the process is. Get it from their mouth. So Daniel was one of them in Sacramento. What's the process? What are the grounds to vacate an assessment? I don't need to know the stupid revenue and taxation code. I'm going to ask Daniel about it, right? So he tells me, oh, if we're convinced that there's no evidence, we'll vacate the assessment. Great. Excellent. Is there a factual difference between income and taxable income? Well, yeah. Do you know what they are? You've heard the video, right? There doesn't have to be evidence. Apparently not. Apparently not. That's why the Roman generals, some I forget their name, I think it was Pompey, one of them, he had mentioned, don't call law to us, we carry swords. Cicero was also famous for saying something very similar to that. You don't quote laws to men who carry swords. What's wrong with you? But this is a nonviolent way of approaching it, not being argumentative and getting it thrown out. But it's not just about getting these tickets and everything thrown out. It's about bringing about a voluntary society, which is what the show is about. The show is called The No State Project. And it's not necessarily to get to a stateless society, because we are already there. There are no states. What did John Lennon say? The world is run by the insane for insane purposes? You got that right. Anybody who will do business at the barrel of a gun is insane. They're psychopaths. Now, I don't have all the time to get into a lot of the psychological stuff, but I want to get into how we keep talking about a revolution. And I'm going to borrow the phrase. I know Ian from Free Talk Live doesn't take credit for this. He doesn't know who coined this, but it's not a revolution we're looking for. We're looking for an evolution, that we as humans need to evolve and not be parasites or support parasites, to actually grow up and be men, women, I mean that in both terms, but to actually evolve. Oh, Stefan Molyneux joined us. Welcome, Stefan. It's a matter of evolving as people psychologically and being men, being an adult. Adults stand on their own two feet. They take care of themselves. We work together, but we don't rely on others. Why? What we do with the show is we know what the problem is. It's violence. We need to have an evolution, and so we understand it, but we're not all there yet, to where we're willing to take a stand and live free today. We don't want to whine and complain on the show about the big bad government. We want solutions. The solution is to evolve. It is to start living free now, not asking for permission. So what I describe it as a relentless attack on their legitimacy. And how do you do that? You never ignore the elephant in the room, or as we spoke about so many times, Steph, don't ignore the fact that there's a machine gun under all that paperwork. Ever. It's always on the violence. Should a service or product be provided at the barrel of a gun? Yes or no? If someone says to you yes, do you continue trying to have a rational discussion with this person? No. Are we going to reach everybody? No. Do we need to? No. So don't get in these fits. I get emails from some people, so I just can't get these people to understand. You trying to force them? That's not what it's about. It's about persuasion. Yes?
On the other end of the spectrum, I've perfected the art of the indigent. If the federal, if the government tax board feels you're indigent and you can prove the hardship and so forth, they will leave you alone or ask for $25 a month sometimes. But indigent is a very good way to go, and it's doable.
That's one way to do it. I would not do that. I'd rather just press them and take them. Look, I want to settle with you guys. I want to pay. I don't pay what I can. I can always work out a payment program if I can't afford it. That the taxpayer's advocate is not to help you do anything but pay it. They set you up on a payment schedule. That's all they do. I would rather just put them on the spot to prove it. I will pay you, just put the evidence on the table. We had an indictment dropped against somebody because we went into the IRS office. You know, the client made the appointment, not the IRS. I said, look, all you have to do, I said, all this revolves around an obligation you believe was created that he didn't take care of, right? We won't even discuss civil, criminal, we just want to pay it. You didn't go to the grand jury without facts, did you? No? Okay. All you got to do, put the facts on the table, he'll cut you a check right now, and pull out his credit card to pay you. Really? Yeah. And so we started asking questions about the facts, and we got thrown out. Well, now, the client was initially very upset with me. He flew me out to Indiana. And I wasn't happy to go to Evansville anyway. But, I know, I got a CDI arrest and I have to be in, you know, Evansville. Just type in Google in Evansville sewer. You'll kind of understand. So we get in there, and I, you know, I kind of understood where he was coming from, because in 30, he flew me out at this expense. We were thrown out in 13 minutes. The whole time at the IRS was 13 minutes. What I thought it was significant, and you know, all these years later, you know, because the indictment was dropped and other people went to jail, but he did not. Dick Simcannon was one of the other people that were in that investigation, which he's unfortunately back in prison. Anyway, my turkey farmer, yeah, I have a thing with turkey farmers, he did not get indicted. And so what we had was, we were making an offer to pay. All they had to do was put the facts they said were brought to the grand jury. They threw us out. How do you convince a grand jury or even a, you know, a regular jury that this guy's guilty of tax evasion when you've got a witness and an audio recording that he's trying to pay? And you threw him out because you wouldn't give him the facts. Because the fact not presumed, the fact not appearing is presumed not to. And how do you overcome a presumption or no facts? Put the facts on the table. Can they show taxable income? No, it's impossible. So to get back, we need an evolution, not a revolution. We need to evolve and actually stand up. But most people aren't ready to do that. How many people are ready to start living free today?
I am.
Well, I know you are. Well, what do you think, Calvin? Think we're ready to try that out? We want to see how serious people are about living free. Okay? So what I'm going to do, I want you to catch this. Okay? Oh, you're right. It's lighter than we thought.
Guilty.
Welcome to the world of felony drug possession. So what we're going to do, we're going to weight this down a little bit.
It's over an ounce.
So what we're going to do is we're going to pass this around. We want to make sure the marijuana come back, okay? All right? Okay? So here we go. You've already, you passed that along.
Gonna take some.
Hey now. It's not cocaine. Yeah. We're running at it. We got to speed it up. We got to go quickly. Everyone, pass that around. Okay, great. Well, we'll leave that up to the authorities. So let's get that. Where we got to make sure that comes back. Is there anyone here who's never been accused of a felony? All right, yeah. Let's hear it for felony possession. Let's make sure that goes around to everybody. Yeah. Not yet. They were arguing about that recently. I think the LA chief of police was talking. He said, "Well, we're gonna. Well, you can pass your proposition. We're still going to enforce federal law here." Okay. So. But as we're getting that passed around, yeah, feel free to check it out. But just you see how silly? You see how silly that is? I know some people will say, like, when we had the fishing at a license, well, big deal. But you know what? That's the point, isn't it? Fishing without a license is not a big deal. Would you shoot somebody? For not getting a license? To fish? That's the point. So what we're doing is we're making their law a little less sacred today, aren't we? Yeah. See, the new book is called Government Indicted, and it's ending the worship of the psychopath, which even the LA Times in the last year, a former police profiler of all people, finally took notice of what crazy Canadians like Stefan Molyneux and I have known for how long? Politicians and bureaucrats are psychopaths, right? So finally, the LA Times had a little bit of truth, for the, you know, tell us something. Like, we didn't know that. Oh, we need things like the Bell incident that just happened here recently. Yeah, we needed that to tell us that they were psychopaths. So a relentless attack on their legitimacy, and this is what civil disobedience or nonviolent non-cooperation does. Oh, wow, we've got an illegal alien that's now participating. Thanks, Steph. but that nonviolent non-cooperation. And this is what we're doing. This is what we need. This is one of the things we need to do. Because when other people see, you know what? I may not, and I don't smoke pot. I don't do drugs of any kind. I don't even use aspirin. It drives my wife crazy. I was like, I got a headache, or I'm a little sore. I take an ibuprofen. We got it back.
Everybody? Anybody else?
Anyone else? Anyone not? Did you not get it?
No one back here got it.
No one. Can we? I think this guy will catch it. Yeah. Keep that going. All right, nonviolent non-cooperation. Because, this shows you a number of different things. That the concept of government is false on its face. Because why would they go after somebody if they were not hurting anybody? And like I said, I don't advocate the use of drugs. I don't advocate that anyone use them. But you know what? I don't care if you do. And it's none of my business. That's why the theme show, the theme song for these things should be that old blues song, Ain't Nobody's Business. It ain't your damn business. I may not like it, but you know what? Who cares? That's why I was so surprised when someone told me recently who refused to run my No State Project radio show on a Boston radio station. Thought that libertarianism was the stupidest ideology forced on society. Really? I know. So what I want to accomplish with the radio show, and I know I've come on the show recently and said that, you know, I was kind of wavering on doing the show anymore because I didn't want to just talk about it anymore. We talked to a blue in the face already. We've done it. We know what the problem is the violence. What do we do about it? So that's why I've said on the show, and I'll say here, if you want to complain and whine and groan about the government, call Sean Hannity. Call Jason Lewis. Gosh, they love that kind of stuff. But the moment you talk to them about a solution, what do? They cut you. So what we do on the No State Project every Saturday from 1 to 3 Pacific time is we talk about solutions. I want to know what we can do. And today is just a small part, of course. But what it does is it makes the law a little less sacred. What it also does is it makes people, when they see that, it's called the bandwagon effect. And we really need to take advantage of this. This is our way out to a voluntary society, of course, to psychologically change people. Take advantage of the bandwagon effect. When people see us do things like this, and we got the marijuana back, okay, thank you.
High school teacher.
Well, someone said I look like a gym teacher. Yesterday, but yeah, people will say, you know what? I'm not alone. It's time to be an adult. It's time to stop messing around. Now I know there are risks involved, and I get on the radio show and I give what people would call legal advice every single time now. Every single show I make it a point because we have the weekly civil disobedience spotlight. But you know, I'm getting tired of being the only one. It can't just be me and a few nutcases like Calvin over here. We need to do this. And I'm not saying that we have to have a risk like all becoming felony possession cases. Okay. There are other ways we can do it. And so one of the things that I've come up with and would help me continue doing the show was I had put out the idea that, well, one, having a radio show on where you are routinely calling for a tax revolt and telling people not to pay taxes, not the most not the most marketable show. Although I'm very close to getting on in Phoenix, so we're looking forward to that. Yes, on merit. I won't have to, you know, I don't have to pay for the time, so we're looking forward to that. But that's a pretty high risk thing. It's not as risky for me to do it as for you to do it, because I'm with the IRS on a regular basis. They know who I am. If they ever want to come after me, they'll do it. But I put out the idea, and low-tech junkie, can I use that?
No.
Okay. People like that, I put out the idea of setting up micro broadcasters or setting up your own AM, FM radio broadcast and not getting permission. Now, your chances of going to jail are pretty, well, they're not. There's none. At best, a couple years down the road, they take your equipment. This is a way of really, because Keith had mentioned on, you know, one of the themes of the show is the No State Project, where we're sticking it to the man one show at a time. And that's a way to stick it to them. I mean, why are we going to start talking about libertarianism and voluntarism and agorism and building free markets and ask permission to do it? That's ridiculous. It goes against the whole concept. It's stupid. So the idea was to set up these broadcasters and not ask permission. Of course, we're going to do it. We're not going to step on somebody else's signal. But now that they have the high def, there's a lot of open frequencies. So as long as we don't step. So when I was doing the Axiom conference in Salt Lake City, Brian of We Are Change Alabama called the show and told me that he had just started broadcasting the show, and he's going to be broadcasting other shows that day. It was the last day of July, I believe it was. So he had set up a micro station, 91.1 FM, in Northeast Alabama. I was like, wow, that's what I want to see. Somebody doing something. So we're broadcasting on, you'll be the fourth micro, which is great. So that's something that we can do also. So we can use the micro broadcasters to promote things like your business. And we're teaching people and reaching the community, and we're talking about real truths, verifiable empirical truth, that there is no state, there is no government. We're not looking to the government for a solution. How can we use the radio and the show to promote the community? Well, we've got community currency, things like this. We've got the silver that we're going to have you on a show later, and we can start using silver. Not asking for permission. So we give the community an opportunity to communicate with each other and to trade. And we're not going to ask politicians for permission, because what is the sense? Oh, I have a good idea, Joyce. Why don't we wait until November of 2012 and vote them out? That'll work. Am I about out of time? Okay. So we have the radio show, and everyone is free to call in, except for today. You just have to do it in person today. We're getting that straightened out. We also have challenging tickets. What we do on the show, we spend a lot of time. This is not like that local show here, and on. I don't cut you off after a minute. If you have an attack by a bureaucrat or a tyrant, you call the show, and sometimes we've sometimes spent a whole hour with one caller. But that gives you an opportunity to hear other people, what they're doing and how they're handling it. And so it helps other people say, well, yeah, if they can do it, I can do it. And if we just challenge the ticket, even if you plan, you know what, I'm going to ultimately pay this anyway, I might as well make it as gut-wrenching difficulty as possible for these bastards. Right? Look what they're doing in Keene. They've said that they're having problems staffing the courts in New Hampshire because everyone's challenging. Well, not everyone, but most people, they're purposely doing, well, I would like to think that that was original. They're doing things like the Daily 420 and they're challenging it. And so they're clogging up the courts. So that's another thing to do. If you, even if you're going to ultimately pay it, you make it as difficult as possible. And I've told them, point blank, I cannot change your mind. There's nothing I say in court here today is going to change your mind. But heaven is my witness, boy, this is going to be the most difficult fine you've ever imposed in your life. 30 years from now, you're going to talk about what Marc Stevens did to you in court today. Another last thing, and we'll talk more about it on the show today, I want to see support for others in court. And one of the things you can do that I want people, and you're able to do this, as long as you're professional, you don't have to wear it, you should be dressed like this gentleman here. When you go into court with somebody to support them, which we should be doing, yeah, it should give us a turn. If you know someone who's in court, or you hear someone on the radio, if you're on the form at markstevens.net, you, as long as you're a professional, you can go in, you make sure you tell the bailiff, I am from the media, and out of courtesy to the judge, I want him to know that we're here doing a series of shows on judicial misconduct. Just here to observe. And you're there as a reporter for the No State Project, and then you can call in and you can let us know. But that's going to put them on really, really good behavior. And it shows some support. And other people are going to see you in that courtroom. They're going to see what you're doing. And it's going to embolden them and empower them to then challenge it also. And plus, you give out my card and let them know they can call the show. But I appreciate everyone coming out. I'm sorry for going over time. But I'm glad. I am so happy to be in a room full of no good felons, felony possession. So let's everyone give yourselves a round of applause for a felon. Yeah, felony possession. Nice job. Thank you very much.